We're gonna, tonight's like a girl night, okay? Cause we never do anything for the girls. Is there any girls in the house? Where are the girls at? I wore my long hair tonight, my wig, for the girls. I was gonna put in pigtails. No, tonight's gonna be a girl night, but it's gonna be pretty tough, to be honest, because a lot of what these girls have been through. And you know, I've watched all the movies of the whole Jesus culture or Jesus people movement in the hippie days when Calvary Chapel started, and tonight kind of reminds me of that. Basically, I just got some different girls that got saved, and they have radical stories, and they're gonna just kind of tell their stories tonight, and see what happens. We did this at Shine last week, and it was or Shine last Thursday, and it was epic in Orange County. So before we get going, I want to, I don't know, did any of you guys listen to the radio show last night? It's all right if you didn't, just if there's a couple of you guys, that's cool. It's Saturday night, I get it, trust me. It's for the drive-bys, and we actually got a drive-by. He called in, and I'm like, how'd you hear about it? He's like, I don't know, man, I was just changing to this channels, and you guys were talking about depression, so I tuned in, and I called in, and he basically got a DUI. He was losing his wife, losing everything. It was just this total, like, chaos event that was going on in his life. So we got to tell him about Jesus, and then that opened up a whole can of worms with people with depression and suicide and all these different things. I mean, last night I think was one of the gnarliest shows we had. If you guys want to check it out, if you have someone that's actually going through that stuff, it's on my website. You can send the link out. But we got to pray for a lot of people. When we even hung up the phone, we still had another 8 calls that we couldn't take live. So we just actually went off the air, and we still took them like we were live. And we got to meet with every single one of those people on the phone, because I feel that, you know, every person that God puts in our hands, that's a soul that we're accountable for. You know, I can't just be like, oh, show's over. You want to kill yourself? Okay, well, we don't got enough time today. Maybe call back next week. You know, people do that, though. They do that, believe me. So we don't. We actually, we sit there and we take every single call to the last one. And then we actually have pastors follow up with them after. But tonight, I'm going to introduce first, we're going to have 2 parts of this event tonight. This girl that's going to come out and do spoken word. I met her months ago, probably like, I don't know, 5 months ago. She was in Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa at Shine. She was sitting right there. And I came up to talk to her after. And she didn't want nothing to do with Jesus. She was involved with you know, moving drugs, and she was actually having demons come to her room, and all some like witchcraft, all kinds of crazy stuff was going on with this chick, and she would not accept the Lord. I'm like, just give your life to Jesus. Look at you, you're completely miserable. What's wrong with you? No, bro, no way, no way. I'm out of here. And she just broke out, and I didn't see her. Then next thing you know, she ends up coming, she ends up getting saved, you know, months later, and then she brings one of her friends, and that's kind of how the whole domino effect works when you get saved. You're like, dude, I got forgiveness of sins. I feel peace in my life. My life was going into destruction. Now I'm going into life. I know my purpose that I was created. So that's all you want to do is you want to introduce your friends to this. You know, I heard someone pastor say, being a Christian is like one beggar looking for bread and wait, how does it go? One beggar finding bread and giving it to another beggar. That's what the gospel is. We're searching for something. We're hungry. And then once we find Jesus Christ, he fills that in our life and he gives us eternal life. So anyway, this girl ends up getting saved, and I just kind of seen, she's a little crazy one, but I seen her just doing her thing, and I just love her so much, and just seeing how God's working tremendously in her life. And she hit me up the other day. She's like, man, I do spoken word. I'm like, you gonna get on stage and do it? She's like, no way. I'm like, yeah, let's do it. So I invited her out. This is Melina. Melina, go ahead and come out here.
You know, I don't think I'll ever get used to speaking in front of a crowd this big. So if I throw up or pass out, it's okay. I'll wake up at a certain point. It's all good. Whew. All right. Thank you. I appreciate the looking out. That's awesome, dude. For real. All right. My heart sunk as I looked in the mirror and didn't know the person staring back. No one heard my silent screams for help through the 5 years of sexual abuse I went through as a kid. I felt that God had ignored my prayers and that were like a war cry. I felt he just turned a blind eye and abandoned me when I needed him the most. I hated him. I literally hated him. I spent my entire life running from God. As I got older, I was convinced, completely convinced, that the only way to experience freedom was through the temporary relief I felt from cooking up a shot or twisting the pipe. I became affiliated with people who I called family, and family, as far as I was concerned, were the people who'd have my back in rival territory, or the people who I'd be killing to, will be willing to kill for without hesitation. I frantically grasped onto anything and everything to feel whole. I had lost myself completely. All the masks I wore, all the drugs I did, all of the twisted, and I seriously mean twisted, relationships, all of the running, the hiding, the fighting, the lying, the pride, the stubbornness, the anger, the bitterness, the indifference, everything I had used to try to fill that void left me even more empty, broken, and alone. It wasn't until I fell flat on my face out of exhaustion that I realized that Christ had always been there, patiently waiting for me to surrender. He saw me when I had no life left, thrashed down to the gutter of misery, robbed of joy, laying there helpless, beaten, broken, arms outstretched, reaching out for him with everything I had left in me. And he loved me. He loved me too much to leave me that way. A pastor I've come to love and respect wholeheartedly put it like this. He said, and I quote, "Listen, I've said it before and I'll say it again. I'm making no apologies. The standard of holiness is Jesus Christ. It is not the Christian church. It is not the Christian culture. It is not anything other than the person of Jesus Christ. That is the standard. It has never changed. It never will change. I don't care what any pastor may say. It doesn't matter what any person in the world says about the standard of holiness. The standard of holiness is Jesus Christ. That's it. Period. Nothing to be added." Close quote. Needless to say, nobody in this place, myself included, nobody in the world, rather, can ever be good enough. Nobody can meet that standard. That is the point. That is why Christ came. That is why he died on that cross. That is why he rose again. That's the point. It has absolutely nothing to do with how good we try to be to rack up our self-esteem points. It has everything to do with what Christ accomplished on that cross when he said, "It is finished." That literally means it's finished. Salvation is only found in the name of Jesus Christ, period. It is his love that purifies. It is his love that refines. It is his holiness, righteousness, and purity alone that justifies. It is his extravagant grace and mercy that redeems us from a seemingly hopeless existence. It is his faithfulness that carries us into eternity, which does not start when we die. It begins right now. He is the creator of the universe and everything in it. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and he is also our Father, which means he sees you. He sees you as if you're the only person on the face of this planet. He knows everything about you. He knows your name. He knows where you've been. He knows exactly who you are. He knows all your pain, all your shame, all your fears, all your doubts. He knows your heart. And he loves you. And any excuse or lie that's popping up right now as to why you believe he can't, he loves you in spite of that. You know what? Check this out. Because his love is relentless. You can try to fight him with all the pride and stubbornness you have stored up in you, and you will lose. I don't care what anybody says. It's just a matter of time. Because he will pursue you. He will call out to you. He will reach out and stand in the fires of hell with you just so you can know that he will never let you go and that you can trust him. Christ died so that we wouldn't have to. He died and rose again to bridge the gap that was impossible for us to jump. He died for me. He died for you, knowing that we were going to spit in his face, flip him off, and do things our own way. Because, of course, you know, when things get hard, then we'll hit our knees because we want a savior that we can treat like a genie, not a lord, right? Yeah, no. Totally, totally guilty of that. I will put myself on blast right now just to make this point. Many people want a savior, but they don't want a lord. You cannot have one without the other. God's character is to save, not because of anything we do, but because it's his character. He comes into the world knowing how dark and jacked up it is. He comes into this world knowing everybody's excuses as to why they won't believe. He comes into the world to save the world. He comes into the world to save you and me. God. Satan's mission. Satan busts a mission every single day trying to trip people up, just condemning them. And he loves it. He absolutely loves it. He jumps for joy when condemnation and shame keep us from the throne of grace. Okay? But you can be sure, right here, right now, that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, Romans 8, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, nor any powers, nor things present, nor things to come, neither height nor depth, nor any other thing created can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Do you know him? Do you know him? If not, know this. No one is too screwed up or lost that Christ can't love and redeem. No one. No one. Period. No one. It doesn't matter how far gone you think you are. As long as you are breathing and you have a pulse, there is still hope for redemption. There's no such thing as a lost cause in God's eyes. There's no such thing as a lost cause, period. So you can get that lie from hell out of your head right now. No situation, no matter how impossible it may seem to you, no situation is too hard for God. None. No person, no matter how tough they try to be, walking around angry all the time, putting on their little gangster face, no one can fool God. Trust me, he knows, he sees right through that. He sees right through it, and all he sees is nothing but fear. He knows you're fearful. He knows, he knew I was fearful. Oh my God. If you've got beef with him, it's time to deal with it tonight. He is love. However, he is not a get out of jail free card. You cannot abuse his grace. And you know what? Maybe you guys can relate with me on this because it's super intense. But sometimes I forget that this is his world, that I am living on his planet, I am breathing his air, that he is God and I am not, that he is not my genie that submits to my every demand. He's definitely not. He's not scared of me, neither is he, what's the word, offended by me. So instead of walking around in self-pity, consumed by anger, and how life just isn't fair, and how everybody has done me wrong, and how it's everybody else's fault, it's not my fault, no. So it's gotta be God's fault, right? Wrong. That's complete nonsense. That's like crazy. It goes to show how patient and merciful God really is out of his love for us. Sometimes, God's got to give us a little reality check and trust and believe that he will, but only because he is our Father and he is a good Father. So if any of you, myself included, have anything that you want to say to him, he's right here, waiting to hear what you have to say. But if you're going to, don't look inward and start to drown in self-pity. I totally have that problem. Self-pity, it sucks. Anybody else, please? Anybody? Self-pity? Thank you. All the rest of you guys are liars. All right. Sorry. Okay. And also, don't look down to the ground. Put your face to the ground and try to hide your face from him because you can't. It's impossible. He sees you. He will meet you exactly where you are at in love. No more playing games. No more push-pull with God. He doesn't hang with that, really. You will either know him or you don't. You either follow him or you won't. You either want him or you don't. It is so, it's just that simple. It really is just that simple. No sin is too great that God can't forgive. No sin, none. If you are sitting in your seat, loaded out of your mind, I'm stoked you're here. God wants you here. He wants to speak to you. He really, really does. He wants you to come to him. He wants to free you. He's not mad at you. But he can't force his way into your life. He can't. That wouldn't be love. That's up to you. It's your choice. Whatever addiction, whatever baggage, whatever pain, whatever shame, whatever it is, he wants to set you free from it. because whoever the Son sets free is free indeed. Am I right? Can I get a response? Thank you. All right. I'm not alone up here. It's great. So it's not a question of will he set us free. It's a question of will we surrender to him. It's on us, really. It is. So if you've walked away from him, you can change that tonight. It's nighttime, right? Yeah. You can change that tonight. No more running. No more fighting. No more excuses. It's not the time for that, you guys. We can't keep trying to dig our... We can keep trying to dig ourselves in a black hole that we may have found ourselves in. We can try to get out. Or we can take a step back and realize that God is exactly who he says he is. Meaning that only through him can a life be transformed. Only through him can brokenness and pain be healed. It's only through him. That's it. He's offering a free gift. A free gift of freedom. Seriously, free. That's like my favorite word in the world. Free, okay? Free gift of freedom. He's offering a fresh start. I'm so grateful for that, really. Oh, man. He's offering a new life. If you're here tonight and you don't know him, just surrender and take the gift. I mean, really, just take it. You have nothing to lose and only life to gain. Like, you can keep, like, denying him and he'll keep pursuing you, or you can just surrender and just accept. Like, it's just blatantly how it is. Run to him, hold nothing back, and I promise you, you will be amazed. You will be amazed at how he will meet you exactly where you're at, with nothing but love in his eyes and a purpose for your life. Thank you.
Right on. Rad, right?
How long you been walking with God? Melina, how long you been walking with God? How long you been walking with God?
5 months. Epic. That's deep for 5 months. Right on. Thank you for coming out. All right, I have our friends from Youth. What? Awakening Youth. Our friends from Awakening Youth. Go ahead and come up here, you guys. Go ahead and give them a welcome. And we have mics for you guys, too. Did they bring them out? Let me see. Yeah, I'll grab them. Here you guys go. They have me doing everything tonight. Everyone's on siesta. So anyway, these are my good friends. And they are actually, Tiffany, she's the director from Awakening Youth in Lafayette, Indiana. I met Tiffany, how many, was it last, when was that, 2 years ago?
I don't even remember if it was last year or the year before. Last year.
I know is I was in Australia and we were on the corn tour and she was there with Jenea, and I met them and Crystal was with us and we heard about what she did and we were super stoked on everything. And I told them when they come out to California, we want to get them out to kind of share the vision of what she does, because it's radical. Go ahead and tell us a little bit about your deal.
Wow. Melina, again, following. I'm just like, I mean, when was that? We've only had a few days in between Thursday. And tonight. And do you see, I mean, growth and even, wow, amazing. We are so happy to be here with you tonight. We are from Indiana. Well, I'm from Indiana. All of our girls are from all over the place. And about 15 years, I was a heavy metal chick with piercings and purple hair and did not grow up in a religious home. Wonderful family, loved me. My mom was a teen mom who gave me her youth and cared for me and pulled herself up by her bootstraps and made the decision for life, which I'm really grateful for. And I really paid her back for that sacrifice with being a really wild child, rebellious young woman. And God came into my life in such a dramatic way. It wasn't at a church. I had actually read a vampire book that Jesus was depicted in. And when my life got really awful at 18 years old, I hit my knees in a trailer park and I just called out to the Jesus that I had read about in that book. And he showed up in a dramatic, very real way. And when he came into my heart, I was already at the end of high school. And I knew that I could have made a very large impact in my high school for Christ. But he had stolen those years from me, the enemy had. And so when I came to know the Lord, I cried out and I said, I'm going to spend the rest of my life storming the gates of hell and bringing every young person that I can to a place of wholeness and freedom and relationship with you that I possibly can. And I thought that that would be speaking. I thought that that would be in a church setting. And 15 years ago, when you gave your life to the Lord in the area that I was from, you didn't have piercings and tattoos and purple hair. In submission, when you went to Bible college, you took those things out and you put on a skirt and you learned the Word of God and you really pursued character. And to the best of my ability, I would say that those church leaders might disagree slightly. I submitted wholeheartedly. And I have a passionate love for that church that loved that punk rock girl and wanted to be a part of transforming her into what the Lord had for her. And so I traveled 22 states, 7 countries with a pastor from Indiana. And at one of those places, a vision and a passion for residential ministry really came into my heart. And I saw that if you knew their name, if you lived with them, if you had a group small enough that you could pour your life, not necessarily from a pulpit, but you know, from your bedroom in a robe at 11 o'clock at night, or right in the moment when they were feeling the rejection, the hurt, the pain, that you could really make a transformational impact. And so the Lord has really blessed us with gifted, called, chosen, loved women, young women from all over the country. And so I don't want to be dishonest when I say our girls are wonderful and gifted and beautiful, and I never put them on display as troubled teens. And so I don't want you to feel like in my language, when I refer to them and I kind of have them share testimony, I don't want them with that label, because I believe that we speak life and we speak freedom over them. And so the Whosoever movement is really deep in our hearts. I always thought that subculture ministry and ministry to the radical wild would be what I would be called in the middle of. And so to be here with all of you is just exciting and wonderful. And we get to see these young ladies' lives and their families' lives completely transformed by Jesus. And our 15 to 18 month, I don't even use the word program. I really feel like it's an experience. And so we have an awakening experience. And during that time, we travel to 35 states. They get to taste test all kinds of exciting things. They're very different and unique individually. And so we try to design this experience that it awakens inside of them their individual calling, who they are, and develop a plan for their individual situation. So that's
awesome,
what we do.
Awesome, right on. We'll introduce these ladies that you have.
Thank you. This is Natasha, and this is Janaea.
Natasha, where are you from?
I'm originally from Russia, and I was adopted 4 years ago by an American family, an amazing family. And right now I live in Indiana, which is kind of funny because my school is Indiana also.
She's our only Indiana girl. So she's the only one from Indiana.
Yeah, because there's actually 12 of them here with you.
Yes.
And they're from all over, like Philly.
Alaska. Yeah, California, Las Vegas, yeah.
They're all over the place. And what is your name?
My name is Janaea.
Janaea. And where'd you grow up, Janaea?
I grew up here in California.
Some of you guys may recognize Janaea. And if you do, then that's cool. She's been around here a bunch before. I've known Janaea for like 5 years, we were talking about. And it's just cool to see the transformation of Janaea. But let's go into, because I know there's a lot of girls here. I talked to a lot of the younger girls here. Some are dealing with depression. Some are dealing with self-harm. Some are dealing with anger. Some are dealing with identifying their sexuality. A lot of that stuff on the phone calls on radio, but also there's a lot here in the church. I know that you guys have went through some of that stuff. So let's start with, we'll start with you, Janaea. What were you going through? What were you dealing with before you went to Youth Awakening? What were some of the struggles and life issues that you were battling with that you could not overcome?
Okay. Well, for starters, I was raised by a single dad. My mom left when I was about 3 years old. And so it's just been me and him this whole time. And I guess growing up without a mother figure in my life, I was in lack. And I felt like there was just this thing that, like, this nurturing need that my heart was tugging on, and I was like, what is this hole? I don't know how to fill this. And so so growing up, I kind of didn't know where to find a positive filler of that hole. Like, I turned to all these negative things. I turned to drugs, sex, whatever, self-harm. Self-harm was a big thing. I didn't know. I had all this angst and this anger. Why did my mom leave me? Why do all these people, blah, blah, blah? And I turned to self-harm, and I had this depression, really deep depression, and I didn't know where to turn. And my dad didn't either. He tried his best, and he was amazing. But he found Awakening Youth, and I found a mother figure in my life to support me and help me and just walk through all the struggles in life. So
now, when we were backstage, I heard you talk, you got you two talking something about, like, you were really closing, like, the mother figure out of your life. What was that all about? You guys were talking about during that time.
Because of those hurts, I guess. Mm-hmm. Emotionally, I shut all female figures out of my life. Out. I wanted nothing to do with it, just because I didn't want to get disappointed.
Yeah.
So it was definitely hard, but she showed me that what a real Christian is and what a real Christian walk is, and just, I don't know, just showing what a real friend is, despite mother figure or whatever, or just a real friend and someone who really cares and is there for me no matter what circumstance I'm in.
Showing, like, the real Christian walk, like, yes. Christians that actually make mistakes all the time.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's like a normal Christian. They're not perfect. Yeah. We make mistakes a lot, but she was, like, always the same, you know? Like,
absolutely.
Yeah, cool. And what about you? What were you going through at that time? What led you to the point to where you decided you had to change it all?
Well, like I said before, I was adopted 4 years ago from Russia, and before that, I lived in an orphanage. And it started from when I was very little. I got abandoned by my birth parents. I was always felt alone, and I was depressed, and I thought that I would never find somebody that loves me and who wants to take care of me. And when I got adopted by this amazing family who said they love me, they gave me a house, they gave me everything I needed and what I don't needed. And I still didn't understand why these strange people say they love me. They don't know me, they never, like, seen me before, and they opened their doors for me. And so that was, like, one of the things that I struggled was with love and trust and anger. I didn't understand anything. And it went to that point that I would, you know, self-harm too, and just physically abuse the people that I love, you know, and emotionally. And it was just hard for me to be connected with them. I couldn't understand, and so my family, they tried so hard. They tried everything they could, and they just couldn't deal with me anymore. And then they found Awakening Youth, Miss Tiffany, and she helped me a lot. She helped me understand on the things that I was struggling. You know, she helped me understand how could these people love me after everything, you know? And she just been with me the whole time through the hard times and the most amazing times of my life too. And I really opened up my heart to that. And I saw that, you know, that these people do love me. And now I know. So
I know Tiffany very well, and I know she's always pointing to Jesus, always pointing to Jesus. And you know, I've talked to a couple of different people here. I deal with anger too from my past. You know, it pops up every once in a while. You know how that is, you know, amongst other things. But what was it? If you could give any advice to maybe some girls here that are dealing with anger, what would you point them to? How would
My anger, like I had a lot of trouble with anger, especially with God. Everything I went through, I blamed God for it. I was like, why would you put me through it? What did I ever do? What did I do to deserve this? I didn't believe in him. I said, you know, the things I shouldn't have said. I always blamed him for it. But then he revealed himself to me by giving me a new beginning. He gave me everything new, new family and everything. And the way I deal it right now is by trusting the Lord and trusting Miss Tiffany and my parents that everything's gonna be all right. Even though I go through those struggles, I have people there with me, you know, who never let me down and never will leave me. You know, they're always there, and I know that God is with me too. And it just helps me, you know, to come down and understand, and then, you know, just part of my life.
So it would be safe to say that you just keep pressing into Jesus, and he's there for you, and he's helping you to overcome this this anger when it comes back up.
Yeah, I just gave everything to him. I tell him everything. He knows everything, and I feel much calmer.
That's the confessing, you know, when Jesus says, you know, repenting is like confessing. As we confess our sins, it seems like this weight comes up. Like, I know I said this at the other Shine, but when I was in that hotel room telling my friends that I was an alcoholic, I've never told anyone I was an alcoholic for 23 years. And for me to get that alcoholic out of my throat right here, it was the gnarliest thing. But once I confessed it, just like freedom came with it. And I think that's the ongoing process with Jesus Christ is, God, help me to forgive. God, help me with this anger. God, help me to overcome, you know, these porn problems. God, help me to overcome, you know, it's just always confessing.
And I just want to say too, the impact that all of you can have, like to hear them say that, it's hard to sit there, you know, it's hard to sit in the middle, and knowing yourself, you know, and I just want, I want to be 100% authentic. And I think why the relationship and discipleship is able to happen is 100% authenticity. And we are not the answer. And just like these are the 12 that I live with, that I get to impact, you living that authentic faith, like Melina up here bearing her heart and sharing the way that she did, and your individual thing will impact people to your left and to your right. And it's so important, I think, when you're here, that people are listening and they're encouraged. But, I mean, I was nothing but like a funky punk rock kid that, you know, had all kinds of things about, I don't know, the world. And it just took real Christians to be invested in my life that didn't try to be hip or cool or with it, or they just were themselves. And I think that for anything, for you to see what you living that way and you committing to discipleship and knowing someone's name, knowing their name, knowing their struggle, so that when the person's angry, like you can say, hey, the truth is you have an amazing mom. You have an amazing dad. You have an amazing sister, amazing brother. The truth is you are not forgotten. God did not, you know, abandon you, and he's going to fill things, not replace things, but fill those needs. And that, I think, is the core of why this works. And it's applicable not just at a program experience like what we do. It's applicable with your neighbor, with your friend, in your high school, you know, with the people that you hang out with, you know, with your kids' friends. It's applicable there too.
Awesome. I want you to talk a little bit about the pornography with the girls, but really quick, what, Janae, do you have anything to say to anyone that's here, any young girls, And there's guys that do self-harm as well. And there, I've even met with guys that have eating disorders as well. So any of that stuff, what would you say to them if they're in the middle of it? What worked for you? What was the steps would you do to overcome that stuff?
Well, I think one thing that really pointed me to the right direction was I'm not alone. And
mm-hmm. Yeah.
I guess my self-harm I felt like was birthed out of angst, and I had all these like internal feelings I didn't know how to deal with. Mm-hmm. And so I guess just know that you are not alone and that you are surrounded by people who love you and care about you, and know that despite what you've heard and what you've seen and what you've experienced, Jesus is so real and he loves you, and he can fill that place that hurts and that yearns for love and acceptance and caring. And that's what did it for me, just knowing that he's real and he's not some hoity-toity, like, mm-hmm. what's that guy on The Simpsons?
Ned Flanders.
Yes, yes. Sorry.
He can be Ned Flanders, and I love Ned Flanders.
Yes, absolutely.
He can be him, too.
Yeah, he can be him, and that's okay. But he's not cheesy, and he's mm-hmm. real, and he loves, and he cares, and he wants you. I guess that's
it. That's the answer.
Yep.
Right on. Hey, let's talk about pornography, porn. That's a huge. I shout it from the rooftops here because it's a big issue. Let's talk about girls and pornography.
Yeah, and you hit it too when you're talking about, you know, young men and eating disorders and self-harm also. What I have found over a decade of doing this ministry is, I would go to youth conferences and I would hear, we're going to separate the boys and the girls. You know, and we're going to talk to the boys about porn and being, you know, men of God and not putting women in those situations, and, you know, pornography and your lust, and you need to deal with your lust issues. And then you would set the girls aside, and it would be, you know, purity and saving yourself and forgiving, you know, people that have, you know, men that have porn issues. And I saw such a huge chasm from my own experience. And I think as social media has increased, the thing that I see in my office, and it doesn't matter if it's a girl who's totally church and absolutely protected and has both parents in the home, or a girl that has been totally abandoned and doesn't have family and has drug and alcohol issues. Pornography continues to become a point with women, and it's not addressed in our church circles, in our conferences, in our teaching. And it's a powerful thing to be up against, because as a man, you're looking at porn and you're getting attached in a lust issues and you're putting unrealistic expectations on another person. When you're a woman who engages in pornography, you're putting unrealistic expectations on yourself as a woman. And it's a major issue that's running rampant through the church, and young women are carrying huge shame. Unbelievable shame, thinking that they're messed up or that they're creepy or that they have, you know, major problems because they engage in watching pornography. And it's a huge underlying thing that I think holds a lot of things, you know, a lot of people back and holds them in chains, and it's not addressed for women.
There it is. Do you have anything else you want to say on that porn? What do you suggest to those women that are in it? Right,
opening
now.
The dialogue and finding Christian women that have healthy sexual relationships with their spouses, that have confidence in themselves, and that can teach you and share with you things that nobody wants to talk about. You know, and nobody wants to talk about the awkward sex and saving yourself for marriage and what that looks like, and nobody wants to have those conversations. And I think that if young people would rise up and start asking those questions of the women in the church that are married, that are confident, that do have good relationships, I think that there's a healing and even an information exchange that needs to happen. And my encouragement to those of you in the church that it's an awkward topic, to really begin to share that sex within the marriage relationship is something that is wonderful and fun and spontaneous and all those things, but we don't want to talk about it. And so I want to encourage young women in here that are in shame. You're not alone. Even if the only thing that you hear from me on this topic is, you're not alone. You're not the only girl that's looking at porn on your phone. You're not the only one that's engaging in that. You're not the only one that thinks that you have to have a thong and fake boobs and a duck face to be attractive by a man. It's not true. It's not the reality. And there are men that are out there that are waiting for you, that want to have a wonderful, amazing sexual relationship with you. And you know what's amazing about them is that they're going to stand before God and your family and their family, and they're going to declare that you are their bride and you are the one woman, and they're going to enjoy your body and love your body with every imperfection, every funky smell, every noise, every awkwardness that happens in sexuality. They are going to love you and want you and be a part of that journey with you. And you don't have to be your whale tail hanging out, promiscuous, nasty, to engage in that, and know that there's nothing wrong with you for wanting and feeling sexual. There's nothing wrong with you for having hormones and a body, and you don't have to change it or nip it or tuck it. There, I guarantee you that there is a man out there that you were made for that is going to love you and want you, and you don't have to compare yourself to those women in pornography. You do not.
Thank you. And Tiffany will be back for the next women's conference.
And one more thing, and if you would ask, and here's the thing I think too, that we shy away from, and I'm gonna say it, okay? When you're not in God and you are a confident woman, okay? You love sex. You love sexuality and how it feels, and it empowers you and it brings you this place. It's not always this, you know, I think as a church we say it's this dirty secret and it's awful and, you know, all porn stars are miserable. No, they're not. There's a lot of porn stars out there that are making a lot of money and thinking that they're loving it, okay? That is truth, because Satan has a counterfeit. And his counterfeit for them is pornography. His counterfeit for them is the empowerment and the money that they get from objectifying themselves. And there are some that are happy. But when you peel that layer back and you find these authentic women, and what they really want is this marriage relationship. What they really want is to be loved without the agenda, without the, you know, the fake and the extensions and the teeth, and that they just, at the end of the day, want to be loved. And there's some, like Annie, that will share with you and the experience and how it's related to human trafficking and all those things. But I think that when these young people, they hear those stories, and sometimes it impacts them, but other times it's like, well, no, there's women that are loving it. You know, they're on reality television and they're loving it. The thing is that there's an emptiness, and you're not alone in that. And there's not the separation between the world and the church, and there shouldn't be. Sorry.
Awesome, right on.
That's my thoughts.
Good stuff right there. Excellent. Annie Lobert's been here a bunch of times, so we're all familiar with Annie. So girls, you know, in wrapping it up, now that you went through hell, you found God, what's God doing in your life now? What's next in your guys' life? How old are you again?
I'm 17.
17, and how old are you?
19.
We'll start with Janae. What's your plan now? What do you think God's leading you to do?
I have a lot of interests. I love music, I love fashion, I love art, I love those kinds of things. But I feel right now I'm definitely called to music. Mm-hmm. And I love music, I love worshiping, I think it's amazing. And so right now I guess I'm just growing in God and learning more about Him and preparing me for college and whatever He has in store for me. So
cool. Do you have any last words to any of the girls?
You are loved. You are so loved. That's all.
Awesome. So what's God calling you to do, Russia?
I feel like a lot of people ask me that question. You know, what do you want to do? Who do you want to be when you grow up? And it's so hard because I know I'm 19 and I'm supposed to think about college. I don't really know. I don't know. Whatever's, you know, I'm kind of go with the flow. But I have these amazing people like my family who changed my life so much. You know, they literally took me out of the dirt bag and put me here. You know, even being here is so amazing. And having a person like Miss Tiffany who gave me a 360 spin around in my life and really showed me what could I do with my life. And just by having these people in my life makes me wanna be, you know, somebody's, like, the person that who could look up to. And if I could, you know, change somebody's life, not as many as Miss Tiffany have, not as many as my parents have, but just one person, and I feel like that would satisfy me, you know, and I don't have to be some professional businesswoman or something like that. I feel like if I could just help one person, you know, that would be enough.
God's gonna use you to touch people, for sure. Do you have any last words to the girls here?
I just wanted you guys to know, like, there's a lot of people, and I was one of them, who pretended to be someone that I'm not just to impress a guy or fit in with the people. And you don't have to be somebody you're not, because God created you just the way you are, and you're beautiful, because there's nothing more amazing and beautiful than God's creation. You know, and just embrace that and be who you are.
You have any last words, Tiffany?
I want to thank you for what you do.
Yes.
What you do
Absolutely.
Is amazing. And even within the whosoevers, you know, people I think that don't understand what, you know, the subculture movement or what is the whosoevers. And I look at, it's just not, okay, rock and roll, it's just not surfer, skate. No. But you have, even within your founding dynamic, you know, Sunny, who, the Christian thing in music, the whole way, never relenting, when everybody says you can't do that, total career musician. You have Brian, who walked away, you know, from some of the biggest success that you can in music, and then felt God calling him back, which is something that blows most people's minds.
Absolutely.
And then you have Lacey, who just walked away, you know, at the height to follow and pursue what God has for her. And you, you know, with Father in Ministry and Prodigal, walking back on a stage that says Shine, and giving opportunity and seeing in people, like, I just want to say to you, thank you for just throwing Melina on a stage. Thank you for meeting, you know, just a lady from Indiana that has 18 kids that lives in her house and saying, come to California and be on a stage and, like, talk. Thank you for walking out of everything that you must have seen as a pastor's kid and everything that you walked through in success and drug addiction and being so transparent and welcoming people to this stage that would not make it into the church speaking circuit or into the way without somebody like you just flinging the doors and saying, yeah, let's, like, let Jesus rock. And so that's my last thing. Thank you, whosoevers,
awesome.
For being absolutely awesome and so hospitable and authentic. I love it. I love it. And as a punk rock chick that got saved 15 years ago, and I love the traditional church, but to be able to be alive at a time where there are Christians doing what you guys are doing is so cool. And thank you.
Thank you very much.